Good afternoon. Delighted to welcome you on behalf of the McLean Center for Medical Ethics, the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, and the Buxbaum Institute to this, our 21st lecture in the 2016-17 series on reproductive ethics. Before I introduce our speaker, I just learned moments ago from Dr. Julie Kaur, raise your hand, Julie, who along with Katie Watson from Northwestern has been working with Oxford University Press to possibly print the papers that have come out of this series. And Julie tells me that just earlier this week, she's heard from Oxford that it's quite likely that this will go through and that the series then will be available in time as a printed volume. So Julie, congratulations. It's now my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Professor David Strauss. Before joining the law school faculty in 1984, Professor Strauss worked as an attorney advisor in the Office of Legal Counsel of the U.S. Department of Justice and was an assistant to the Solicitor General of the United States. David has published on a wide range of subjects. One of his greatest distinctions is his recognition as an expert in constitutional law. He's the author of a book called The Living Constitution, also published by Oxford University Press. Along with Jeff Stone and Dennis Hutchinson, Professor Strauss edits something called the Supreme Court Review, an in-depth annual analysis and critique of Supreme Court's recent decisions. Professor Strauss has argued 18 cases before the Supreme Court. In 1990, he served as special counsel to the Committee on the Judiciary of the U.S. Senate. He served as chair of the Board of Trustees of the University of Chicago Lab Schools. He did so while our four kids were there, and he did a fabulous job. And as a member of the Board of Governors of the Chicago Council of Lawyers, and as a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Today, Professor Strauss will talk to us on the title, Legal History of Contraception and Abortion in the United States. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to David Strauss.
Dr. Siegler, thank you, Dr. Siegler and Dr. Kaur, for inviting me to speak to you all, and thank you all for coming. A colleague of mine got my talk jumbled up on her schedule with another talk, and the other talk was entitled A Woman's Perspective on Receiving Care in a Religiously Affiliated Institution, and she sent me an email saying, Could you send me the text of your talk? So if that's what you were expecting, I think that's probably a lot more interesting than what you're going to get from me. But however qualified or not I am to talk on this subject, which is something you'll have to figure out as the session goes along, however qualified I am to talk about this, I guarantee you I wasn't qualified to talk about the other subject. So what I would like to say a few things about is the legal history of the abortion contraception. I want to focus especially on recent developments in the news. Precedents and the customs and is generally acknowledged as an authority and is very influential in the U.S. The significance of English common law to us is when the colonies broke free from England, they, of course, didn't try to reinvent everything. They adopted English common law, and it became the law in the colonies and then was subsequently modified. But it was very influential at the beginning and actually continues to be influential today. The key distinction there, so far as we can tell, was the distinction between quickening and the period of time in pregnancy before quickening. Quickening when the woman could feel the child in her. Abortion, so far as we can tell, abortion after quickening, even after quickening, was generally treated as a minor crime, sometimes apparently not even treated as unlawful. We can't really tell, there's not really clear how many prosecutions there were, so we're not sure about that. We do know abortifacients were available then. Abortifacients were available in classical Greece, so they were certainly available in early modern England. But so far as we can tell, at least it was not a big deal. It was not something that the authorities viewed as a high priority for law enforcement. The big change in the United States, which inherited, as I said, this body of law from England, the big change in the United States really didn't happen until the 19th century, and really not until well into the 19th century, about the 1820s or 1830s. And it happened, or as I say here, about 1840. It happened after, and probably at least to some degree, as a result of the so-called Second Great Awakening. The Second Great Awakening was a burst of religious and especially evangelical activity among Protestant churches in the United States at that time, in the early decades of the 19th century. And that religious revival seems to have led to, in any event there was, a series of laws in many places forbidding post-quickening abortion. Now these laws were generally directed not at women themselves, but at the apothecaries who are providing the drugs. Abortion was generally conducted that way. As you might suspect, surgical abortions were, surgery generally was primitive, and surgical abortions were hardly known. The other notable thing, as I say, is that the line between abortion and contraception was not clear, and a lot of products were marketed as things you could do to stave off pregnancy and things like that. And it really wasn't clear whether these were contraceptive means or abortifacients, and of course a lot of them were probably neither, or a lot of them were probably just toxic chemicals that had very uncertain effects on women. So the way we think of things today, where well, there are contraceptives and then there's abortion, and those are really sort of different universes, that wasn't at all clear back when these laws started to get going. In any event, by 1841, there was a distinct departure from the earlier English way of approaching these issues, and 10 states, which is then, as you see, almost over a third of the states in the United States, forbade abortion post-quickening. Pre-quickening abortions, so far as we can tell, either were legal or they were treated as minor crimes, misdemeanors, at least up until the Civil War. The other notable thing about this period is the role of the AMA. The AMA at this point was really just coming into being. There were issues about whether it would be influential, whether doctors would be recognized as a profession. The AMA was trying to establish itself and trying to establish its role in the profession. And the AMA, after some internal controversy, took a position strongly opposed to abortion. Now, the AMA, of course, did not represent all doctors, but it did take this position, and it was the people in the AMA who moved for this position were explicitly influenced by their religious commitment. So here's where you really begin to see what we know very well today, which is the commitment of religious groups, certain religious groups, on this issue, to take this as a high priority issue and something they wanted to take, and a very explicit, very public, and they hope very influential stand on them. The next era in this story has to do with this guy, Comstock. He was a crusader against a bunch of stuff. He was a crusader against obscenity, as he did. He was a crusader against contraception. Also against abortion, although contraception is really the bigger issue. I don't want to glance over his picture that quickly, because, I mean, you know, why would you not want to stare at that for a while? He was a major figure at the time, really a very influential figure in this period. He focused on federal laws because he thought that would be more effective than operating at the state level. And the federal government at the time did not have the sorts of powers that it had today. So a lot of the laws directed at obscenity, but also for our purposes directed at contraception and to limited degree of abortion, a lot of it had to do with the mail. Were you putting things in the mail? Because the federal government can regulate the mail. So the Comstock Act of 1873 forbade the mailing of contraceptive devices or advertisements for abortion or contraception. And this was sort of seen. There were also laws inspired by Comstock that forbade the mailing of obscene material. And this is all seen as part of the same package. This is all kind of the same stuff. Today, of course, that's not. I mean, obscenity law, the extent it exists today, is really hardly anything left to it. But it's certainly seen as quite distinct from these issues about contraception and abortion. Not so back then. This was all bundled into one sort of package of unhealthy things having to do, closely unhealthy things having to do with sex. And Comstock was a big mover. A meaningless little personal anecdote. Mark mentioned that I argued some cases in the Supreme Court. Many of them I argued when I was in the Justice Department representing the United States. And one of my first arguments was a defense of a federal law that forbade the unsolicited mailing of advertisements for contraceptive products. When you work for the federal government, you're a lawyer for the federal government, in most cases, we'll defend the laws on the books unless they are utterly indefensible. It's your job to defend them, even if you think they're not good laws. Congress passed them, you're in the executive branch. You defend them. So I was 28 years old at the time, and I was up there defending this law. And there were these stories in the newspapers about, or the TV about this case. And what did all the stories feature? That's what they featured. About my case. I mean, that's kind of who I was, and I didn't like that. And we got clobbered in the case. We lost 9-0, but we probably just, I didn't think so at the time, but we probably deserved to lose. One other anecdote from that? Here's another little anecdote from that. One of the arguments we made for the government was, this is unsolicited contraceptive advertisements, and it's reasonable for people not to want mail advertising condoms coming into their homes when they didn't want it, they didn't solicit it, they'd rather it not be there. Their kids might open it and then they have the conversation that you were hoping to have a little bit later, but now you have it now because your kid has opened this thing. So I made this argument for the Supreme Court, and Justice Thurgood Marshall, a great man of the law, one of the great, really, in my view, the greatest lawyer of the 20th century, the leader in the fight against racial segregation, said, Mr. Strauss, if my kids ever open a piece of my mail, I'd never let them do that. Now, when a justice says that to you, there are a limited number of things you can say back to them. One of the things that you can say back to them, but that unfortunately at that point I couldn't, was, Justice Marshall, my kids open my mail all the time. Now, I didn't have any kids then, so I couldn't say that, because you can't lie to the Supreme Court. Anyway, the Comstock law survived. The point is, to the extent that the anecdote has a point, the point is that the Comstock law survived up until whatever year that was, the mid-1980s, in some form or another, until they were either repealed or the Supreme Court said they were unconstitutional. In addition to the federal Comstock law having to do with the mail, there are also so-called Little Comstock Acts in some states, which are often much more severe. And the enforcement of these laws often took a very ugly turn with people, generally, I think so far as I know, entirely women who were trying to provide contraceptives, being, and in some cases, dragged out of their storefronts, punished criminally, locked up in prison for extended periods of time because they were distributing contraceptive products in violation of these state laws. Comstock himself, he was actually appointed a special postal inspector, so he could himself enforce these laws against the mailing of contraceptive devices. So it wasn't exactly a vigilante campaign, but it had some of the feel of a vigilante campaign against the distribution of contraceptive devices. So in a matter of less than a century, the United States went from a place in which, you know, maybe late abortions were criminalized and maybe even then not that severely, to a place where if you distributed contraceptive devices, you could be physically attacked by a law enforcement officer and imprisoned for a year or more. So that was, you know, a dramatic change during this time, and customarily attributed to the results of the Great Awakening, not to sort of suggest that people involved in the religious revival were in favor of these draconian measures, but the origin of it seems to lie in that period. By the late 19th century, you had this situation. There were laws forbidding abortion in every state, both pre- and post-quickening. There was an exception if a doctor said that abortion was necessary to save the life of the woman. But that's the structure of the laws in every state had laws forbidding it. Most states allowed only that very limited exception. The medical profession was divided, and there was organized opposition to these anti-contraceptive laws and, to some extent, anti-abortion laws, and that organized opposition often included doctors. So the sort of homogeneity that the AMA sought to impose on doctors did not last, and doctors at this point were quite divided. The other notable thing about this period is, despite these sweeping laws, there were, so far as we can tell, enormous amounts of evasion. Now, it's of course hard to figure out how much evasion there is, because by definition, people are not breaking the law openly. By definition, it's evasion, and people are not going to break the law openly. So then, as was true up until Roe against Wade, it's very difficult to get accurate numbers on the number of illegal abortions. But so far as we can tell, they were very substantial. And there's your number. So far as we can tell, about one-third of pregnancies ended in abortion, despite these extremely severe laws in the background of harsh enforcement. Okay, the next era belongs to, as much as anyone, to Margaret Sanger. Margaret Sanger was a crusader for contraception in particular, also for liberalizing abortion laws, but very much for promoting contraception, making contraception widely available to women. This was another sort of turning point, a sort of turning point in the early part of the 19th century and then a turning point at the very beginning of the 20th century. Lots of things were going on in American society this time, of course. Much more urbanization, people living in cities, people leaving farms, living in cities, much more immigration at this time. I think the first, I think this is accurate, it's at least close to being accurate, the first decade of the 20th century, on a percentage basis relative to the population of the country, there are more immigrants entering the country in that decade than in any decade since, relative to the population of the United States. So a tremendous amount of immigration. To some extent, women moving into the workforce, a reexamination of women's role, and all of that was sort of part of these challenges to anti-contraceptive laws by people like Margaret Sanger. They often took the form of civil disobedience, of deliberately violating the law to make a point, of being imprisoned in order to set yourself up as a sort of exemplar of this movement. Sort of more open acknowledgement of women's sexuality, revolt against what was seen as the Victorian repression of the late 19th century. All of these things sort of part of the package that included efforts to liberalize abortion and contraception laws. Contraception was the bigger arena of controversy at the time. It was controversial. I mean, it was like Margaret Sanger conquered the world, but this was now much more of an overt presence than it had been even a few decades before, when the opposition was much more covert and evasive rather than open and challenging these laws. Now, a part of this picture, and I don't want to overstate this because I actually don't know enough to give you a sense of how much a part of this picture it was, but it was part of the picture, was this, that there was an element in these attacks on anti-contraception laws and some extent anti-abortion laws, but as I said, really contraception, emphasis on birth control. There are elements of nativism and anti-Catholicism in there. The Catholic Church was then, as even now, a big opponent of contraception and abortion, was a big player in politics, and to some extent this was, these movements were set up in opposition to what they perceived as the excessive influence of the Catholic Church in politics. But it went beyond that. There were undertones of really prejudice against Catholics in the United States. As I said, this is a period of enormous immigration, especially immigration from Catholic countries, Ireland and Italy. And the feeling that these people are diluting our stock and they will reproduce much more rapidly than we do. That was part of it. Now, as I say, how big a part it was, I don't really want to say. I think there's controversy about the extent to which Margaret Sanger herself subscribed to these ideas. I don't want to suggest that about her. But it was a piece of this, the opposition to immigration, this feeling of the country that if birth control were not made widely available and more or less kind of pushed into the culture, that these people would take over and dilute the Protestant stock of America. That was a piece of it. So I say, how big a piece, I can't say. But that's something that really can be ignored. By the 1930s, or in the 1930s, you began to see opinion generally changing, and the opposition to contraception diminishing, and a sense that contraception ought to be made freely available becoming the dominant view. The AMA officially changed its view in 37. And then between 1940 and 1970, you saw really a rollback of the laws that had been put in place in the 19th century. By 1960, nearly every state had repealed its anti-contraception laws. Once the pill was licensed for widespread use, of course, the terrain just changed dramatically. The other thing going on, and this ties into today's debate, is about abortion laws. And there were really two distinct phases, and this is a part of the story that's actually still with us in important ways today. Between 1967 and 1970, you had a very substantial wave of liberalization, if that's the word you want to use. I don't want to beg any questions about the morality of abortion, but just to have a term to use, of making abortion more freely available. There you have the numbers, therapeutic abortions, meaning that an abortion would be legal if a physician said it was needed to protect the health of the mother, a much easier standard to satisfy than the life of the mother, which was the standard in some states before then. Health being left vaguely defined to include lots of things, it was often relatively easy for women to get therapeutic abortions. And four states simply permitted first trimester abortions full stop without any requirement of a doctor certifying anything. Still, two-thirds of the states forbade abortion and allowed only the old exception for the life of the mother. But the movement took place during that period, 67 to 70. And the feeling at that time was, okay, this is the wave of the future, that abortion laws are going to be liberalized, abortion is going to become more freely available. It started with a sort of big urban state and was going to spread throughout the country. That was the feeling at the time. 1970, that stopped. And of course, they didn't know that then. We only know that in retrospect. In 1970, that stopped. There were no further liberalizations. And there was pushback against the liberalizations. And some of the laws that had made abortion more freely available were almost repealed, often by referendum, which is to say that the liberalizations were conducted by legislatures, but the people who opposed abortion wanted to take it to the people and get the voters to vote against it, not filtered through elite opinion in the legislature. So between 1970 and 1973, you did not, as I say, you did not see any more liberalizations, but it's even more dramatic than that. At the time, there was, if you were trying to gauge where things were going, what was the tide of history, between 67 and 70, you would say, as I said, okay, things are becoming less and less restrictive, more and more liberalized. By 70 to 73, you would be thinking, uh-oh, I got that wrong. Things are being rolled back. I'm not so sure about the tide of history anymore. The next major step did not take place in the legislature, they took place in the courts. And that kind of is where things, I don't want to say where things are today, but the Supreme Court is obviously, and the courts generally, are big players in this issue today. That really began in the mid-60s with Griswold against Connecticut and of course, in Roe against Wade in 73. Griswold is a case that has an outsized importance in constitutional law, but the actual issue it involved was in some ways, I don't want to say trivial, but was not that important an issue. Here was the story. Connecticut was one of the states that had never repealed its anti-contraceptive laws from the Comstock era. And Connecticut still had a law on its books that forbade the use of contraceptives by anyone for the purpose of preventing birth, preventing pregnancy. Now, that meant a married couple, if they used a condom to prevent wife from getting pregnant, would be violating the law. And you might think, come on, do they really enforce this? Well, they didn't enforce it against married couples. How would, what would that look like? It was used to close down birth control clinics in Connecticut. It was not the sort of thing that's on the books that nobody pays any attention to. But that's not quite right. It was used to close down birth control clinics, but in some ways it was an extremely easy case for the Supreme Court to say, oh, come on, this law must be unconstitutional, because it was so invasive and also very easily invaded. The law said it's illegal to use contraceptives for the purpose of preventing pregnancy. If you're using it to prevent disease, well, then you're in the clear. Well, try enforcing that law against a couple, apart from the difficulties of proof and so on. So the law came to the Supreme Court as an outlier. Connecticut was the only place anymore that had a law like this, and also as this thing that no one really took seriously, but was used to harass birth control clinics in New Haven. And the Supreme Court said that's unconstitutional. Now, it was a controversial decision. This was just a sort of a more than you need or I bet want to know about constitutional law. It was a kind of controversial decision because it was difficult to identify any specific provision of the Constitution that said anything about contraception or abortion or anything like that. And the court kind of, the majority opinion to the court kind of cobbled together a bunch of stuff and said, well, you've got this amendment talks about speech, and you've got this one talks about self-incrimination, and you've got this one talks about search and seizures, and they all kind of have to do with privacy, and this also has to do with privacy. It was put together. That was pretty unconvincing. Another opinion that talked about tradition, a little bit more convincing. One of the opinions talked about the outlier status of the law, which is, a little bit closer to what you might think would be a constitutional principle, that if everybody else has gotten rid of a law, maybe the state could too. But the basis for it was uncertain. You could not point to a provision of the Constitution and say, oh, this infringes free speech or freedom of religion, or imposes a cruel and unusual punishment. The significance of that is that when Roe against Wade came along in 73, the Supreme Court, we know this from the papers and also from recollections of law clerks at the time, the Supreme Court actually thought, oh, we basically crossed this bridge already. The issue is, is there a right to terminate a pregnancy? And the argument is going to be, well, I don't see anything like that in the Constitution. Okay, fair point, but we've settled that in Griswold. The matters of sexual autonomy are protected in the Constitution in some way that we had trouble articulating then. But in any event, that's now behind us. We've faced that down. Griswold kind of settled in. No one's fussing about it anymore. This is the next logical step. Of course, it turned out to be anything but. Griswold, no one fights about that anymore. No one thinks that contraceptive use should be outlawed, and abortion has not stopped being a divisive issue. The Roe against Wade decision itself established this distinction among trimesters, which the court later abandoned, saying abortion could not be forbidden in the first trimester. In the second trimester, it could be regulated, but only to protect the health of the woman. And the third trimester, because the interest in fetal life there is strong enough, it could be forbidden in order to protect fetal life, with an exception for the health or life of the mother. That was the framework that Roe against Wade set out. The court later abandoned that, or at least modified it substantially. Roe against Wade had this effect of making abortion no longer an issue that was principally being fought out in politics and legislatures, but instead was now going to be fought out in the courts. At the time, it wasn't, when they decided the case, it was not actually clear it would be controversial, even in society at large, quite apart from their view that this is all about things that aren't really in the Constitution, that aren't explicitly in the Constitution, and we settled that. In the opinions of the justice who wrote the opinion of the court in Roe against Wade, Justice Blackmun, in his paper, there was a clipping of a Gallup poll that was taken shortly before the Supreme Court decided the case, in which something like 60% of the country favored free access to abortion, according to this poll. So we know that the justices, and at least the justice who wrote the opinion, very likely all of them, were under the impression that this is going to be not going to be a particularly controversial thing. It's going to be widely accepted. One argument about Roe against Wade, and I don't, this is very controversial in legal and historical circles, but it's an argument. It's been subscribed to by some people who know what they're talking about, is Roe against Wade was actually a setback for the cause of abortion rights. And the reason it was a setback for the cause of abortion rights was it mobilized the opposition. The argument is, you know, liberalization was proceeding step by step in the legislatures. Now, that's not so clear given the pushback in the 70s, 73 years, but this is the argument. Liberalization was proceeding step by step. Roe against Wade came along and just blew past all that. And instead of going step by step and building a consensus in popular opinion, Roe against Wade effectively declared unconstitutional the laws of 46 states, which had more limited abortion rights than Roe against Wade provided, and provided a kind of focal point that opponents of abortion could latch onto, that the Supreme Court is doing this to us. So instead of proponents of abortion liberalization, reproductive rights, being able to go state by state, work their way through the political process, build a consensus in, you know, in Colorado and in Minnesota and New Hampshire and New Jersey, instead of doing that, now the opponents could say, well, this has been done on a nationwide basis without our consent by the court, and that could mobilize opposition. And it is the case that evangelical groups became interested, involved in politics to a greater extent post-Roe against Wade than they had been before. And to some extent, not completely, of course, but to some extent, evangelicals supplanted Catholics as the main source of opposition to abortion among religious groups. And at least temporarily, you can see that aligning with Roe against Wade. Evangelical groups, a lot of them previously, would have nothing to do with politics. They were sort of the separation of the two domains, the sacred and the profane. They weren't interested in what went on earth. They were interested in what went on in heaven. And there's an argument that Roe against Wade changed that. Now, to some extent, that has to be overstated. It has to be more than just a Supreme Court decision. It has to be that there are other things going on at the time if there's going to be that sort of change in the political dynamics that are influenced by religious groups. But the argument is in any event, that Roe against Wade mobilized the opposition, and instead of a kind of incremental movement that would have succeeded in providing abortion rights, on a large scale, you got this very massive pushback against what the Supreme Court had done. One of the people who has endorsed this idea to a degree, not completely, but to a degree, is Ruth Bader Ginsburg, great pioneer of women's rights litigation, who criticized Roe against Wade on this ground and went too far too fast, that the court should have done step by step. It should have said, well, Roe against, the law involved in Roe itself was a Texas law that allowed deception only for the life of the mother. The court shouldn't have done its trimester framework. It could just have said, no, you have to allow an exception for the health of the mother as well. And then let that settle in and then maybe take another step after that. But that would have allowed a consensus to build and avoided mobilizing the opposition and produced a better result in the long run. That's her view. There are a lot of historians who will tell you, some historians at least will tell you, no, that's actually not faithful to the facts. This opposition to abortion rights was building anyway. As the states liberalized abortion, religious groups were paying attention to what was going on. The opposition was going to come out, Roe against Wade or no Roe against Wade. And their argument would be, you know, what Roe against Wade did was to give people a right. And it's a lot harder to take a right away from people than it is to establish it. and to row against Wade, you know, even if to some degree it mobilized the opposition, which, you know, the argument is those people didn't have blinders on. They saw what was coming. They saw people were trying to liberalize abortion laws. They knew they had to organize. But now they were in the position of trying to take something away from people. That's the counter argument. And I know there is no consensus on this view. I don't know enough to know which view is right, and I've actually vacillated in my opinion about it over the years. People dig up more and more evidence about this case. In the late 1980s, as a result of this reaction, there was a concerted campaign to get the Supreme Court to overrule Roe against Wade. In 1989, the Supreme Court decided a case in which it came very close to doing so. Justice Blackmun, the author of the opinion in Roe against Wade, wrote a dramatic, some would say melodramatic, dissent in which he said, you know, I'm very old, I might leave the court soon. When I do, I bet they're going to overrule Roe against Wade. I'm hematizing his dissent. It was more eloquent than that, but really kind of raising the warning flags that Roe against Wade might be overruled and states would then be free to go back to prohibiting abortion. And at that point, an interesting thing happened that to some extent bears out the arguments of people on Ruth Bader and Justice Ginsburg's side of this debate. When Roe became a political, when the possibility of overruling Roe against Wade became to be seen as real, there was actually mobilization in favor of it, and mobilization in favor of, against the efforts to cut back Roe against Wade and to do what the people on that side thought was protecting the rights of reproductive freedom. There were two gubernatorial campaigns in 1989 in New Jersey and Virginia, and abortion was a big issue in the Virginia campaign. It might have been in New Jersey too, I don't remember, but definitely a big issue in the New Jersey campaign, and it was a winning issue for the pro-abortion rights side. That was the consensus among politicians and pollsters. So the way this lends some support to the Justice Ginsburg theory is, you know, Roe against Wade mobilized the opponents and kind of made the proponents of abortion rights complacent. They thought, okay, Supreme Court settled this, we don't have to pay attention to this issue. Once it became clear that there was a possibility Roe against Wade would be overruled, they mobilized, they counter-mobilized. They could no longer be complacent. And it turned out that there was a lot of popular opinion on that side as well. The next big step in the law was this decision by the Supreme Court, which established the Roe against Wade, at least from then until 92 until today, Roe against Wade would not be overruled. The Supreme Court reaffirmed Roe against Wade in Planned Parenthood of Southeast Pennsylvania against Casey, but rearranged its contours, rearranged the legal landscape in these ways. It said pre-viability, abortions cannot be forbidden, but they can be restricted. As long as the restriction does not impose an undue burden. You see the definition of undue burden. It's the kind of thing that gives lawyers a bad name. An undue burden is something that puts a substantial obstacle in the path of a woman. Okay, great, I get it now. An undue burden is a substantial obstacle. What's a substantial obstacle? Well, I bet it's the kind of thing that imposes an undue burden. Really a kind of an unhelpful definition of what exactly a state could do. Post-viability, abortions could be forbidden with the exceptions, which by then had a sort of substantial support over the course of many decades for the life and health of the mother. So predictably, the issue post-Casey, after this case, was what's an undue burden? How far can states go in forbidding pre-viability abortions without imposing an undue burden, which would be unconstitutional? And until recently, and even today, all we've really got is a bunch of examples, not really a coherent theory about what's an undue burden. But here are some examples we have. The most significant one probably is Hyde Amendment and things like the Hyde Amendment, which forbids the use of federal government funds. The Hyde Amendment forbids the federal government funds for abortions with these very limited exceptions. Some states also forbid the use of state funds for abortions with similar exceptions. And the most significant, there's the federal funds potentially could fund abortions in many instances, VA hospitals, for example. But the most significant one, of course, is Medicaid funding for poor people. And that's the federal part of Medicaid funding for abortions is forbidden. Medicaid is a joint federal and state program, of course, and some states allow it, but some do not. Other things that we know are not undue burdens are those three things. Parental consent for if a minor is under 18 and is not emancipated. The judicial bypass means that a state, if the state requires parental consent, it has to allow mechanisms for the child to go to court and say, I can't seek my parents' consent because they'll abuse me. And a court has to be able to authorize it in the absence of parental consent. That's a condition on the state imposing a parental consent requirement. How realistic all of this is, of course, is another question. Spousal notification is the one thing that we knew, we've known for a long time until a recent decision I'll get to in a second. Spousal notification requirement that a pregnant woman notify her spouse, that is an undue burden. One thing that's significant here and that contributes to the lack of a coherent view is the Supreme Court said you can require that before women get an abortion that the doctor or anyone involved in the procedure give her information about an abortion. Now, you could imagine a rule that said what a state has to do is simply provide information that will allow well-informed decisions. That's, as you know, standard requirement in the law and in medicine. But the court went beyond that and said that a state can actually try to affect the decision. A state can actually try to persuade a person not to get an abortion. It doesn't have to play it down the middle. You can try to talk the person out of getting an abortion and provide information with that objective in mind. Now, the reason, whether that's right or wrong is another question, but it does make it difficult to understand exactly what an undue burden is. You could say, the state has to be neutral, and anything that departs from neutrality, that's an undue burden, and that would give you some kind of standard. Once you say, no, a state can actually be in the business of discouraging abortion, it's very difficult to know how far can you go in discouraging it. At what point is discouragement too much discouragement? And that's really what kept us from being a standard that we could identify with clarity. I mean, if you think abortion is a terrible moral wrong, then of course you have no trouble with the court saying, of course, you can discourage it. I wish they could prohibit it, but since they can't prohibit it, absolutely, you should be able to discourage it, and that would be your view. So I'm not saying something on the merits of that. It's just something about where the legal regime kind of holds together and provides the kind of predictability and stability you'd want from a legal regime. The next big step was this very recent case from Texas in Hellerstedt. This actually case came out of a shift in tactics on the part of opponents of abortion. The shift, as I say up there, is there's actually a sort of shift in priorities rather than another shift in tactics. There are really two central ways in which opponents of abortion were trying to make their case in the courts and in politics. One was to emphasize the moral status of fetal life and to say abortion destroys a human life, and that's why it should be prohibited. The other was to focus on the welfare of women and to say abortions are bad for women. They're bad because sometimes women get abused by the abortion providers, and they're bad emotionally and mentally for women. They endanger women's health, mental health, and even physical health. That was the argument. The empirical support for the claims about women's health, so far as I can tell, is not that strong. But the claims were made nonetheless and were persuasive in politics. There was a Supreme Court decision which I haven't given you because it's not a terribly significant thing for the law or practically, but it's a Supreme Court decision upholding a law that forbade a certain late-term abortion, so-called partial birth abortion. And in that opinion, the author of the opinion, Justice Kennedy, who is ordinarily favorable to abortion rights, in fact wrote Hellerstedt, a decision that upheld abortion rights. Justice Kennedy had a line in which he said something like, it would not be at all surprising if women who had abortions later came to regret having abortions, and one reason that this law could forbid abortion is to prevent that from happening. Really accepting this idea that there was, that, that, that the the victims of abortion laws are not just the fetus that has the status of human life, but the woman getting the abortion too. This case, Hellerstedt, came out of, as I said, a shift in priorities to that side of the argument. It involved laws, trap regulations, which is a term used by the opponents, obviously, targeted regulations of abortion providers, regulations like these, that if you're going to provide an abortion, the facility in which you provide it has to meet nearly hospital standards as far as size of rooms, access to emergency medical care, things of that sort. Really very, very burdensome standards that would ordinarily not be needed in a clinic that simply provided abortions, and also that abortion providers have to have admitting provisions at a nearby hospital. Again, the sort of idea being, you know, we're protecting the women. The women could have a complication, they need to be rushed into emergency care, a doctor with admitting privileges will be able to do that more easily. Those are the arguments. Whereas these facilities are run down, they're dirty, they're unsanitary, they do lots of things that endanger women's health. Really a shift to that argument as opposed to you're destroying fetal life. So the Hellerstedt, so those two regulations were unconstitutional. The opinion is written if I said that Hellerstedt was written by Justice Kennedy, I was wrong. It was written by Justice Breyer, but Justice Kennedy voted for it, and he has consistently voted for abortion rights, except in the case I mentioned. This decision, you know, undue burden was very unclear what that meant. This decision didn't actually help a lot. It provided a little bit of guidance, and the guidance it provided was really this first thing. The court said in deciding whether a regulation is an undue burden, you've got to look not just as what extent does it keep women from getting abortions, but is it justified? So if it keeps women from getting abortions, but it doesn't really serve any useful purpose, well, that's an undue burden. And even if the burden on women is not that great, if the purpose it serves is very limited, which is what the court concluded about these two things, then it's an undue burden, even though maybe it doesn't affect women's ability to get abortion that much. It could still be undue. The advocates of these things said, look, if it doesn't interfere that much, it can't be undue. The court said, no, we're going to look at the other side of the ledger. Does it do any good? So that was significant and provided a degree of guidance, because you could just look at, well, do these things provide much benefit at all? If they don't, they're probably unconstitutional, and end the inquiry are there. But the sort of the way the Supreme Court approached it was, you really got to dig into the facts. I mean, how much of a difference does it make if you have admitting privileges? How much of a difference does it make if you have the characteristics of an ambulatory care center? How much of a burden does it impose you there? You know, how many abortion clinics were there in Texas, and where were they, and could women get to them, and where will they go now? Will they be able to, you know, get to the clinics that remain open? There was an issue about, well, women might not be able to get an abortion in El Paso, but they can be right over the line into Mexico, could they get an abortion there? And the court said, no, it's got to, you know, your state, you're responsible for women in your state. You can't just say you can go to some other state and get it. So there was a lot of that very fact-intensive thing, which is what leaves us unclear about what kind of regulations in the future might be upheld. One thing the court did not do that some advocates on the side of extent of abortion rights were urging them to do, they didn't say, the people attacking these Texas regulations said, look, I mean, let's cut to the chase. What's going on here is they don't want women to get abortions. They're not concerned about women's health. They just want to throw up obstacles in the way of women getting abortions. And as long as they're trying, that's what they're trying to do, we shouldn't even get into the question of, are these measures justified? Do they impose excessive burdens? We shouldn't even get into that cost benefit. They can't be acting with the objective of preventing women getting abortions unless they're going to do it openly. If they're going to say, no, we're trying to talk women out of getting abortions, okay, fine. But if they say, oh, no, we're just protecting health, but they're really trying to prevent women getting abortions, the court should say, nothing doing. Do it openly or don't do it. The court did not say that. Of course, generally, reluctant to impugn the motives of legislators, and that's probably what did this today. But that, again, would have given some structure to law in this area, and the court did not provide that. Okay, so here are the kinds of things that remain up for grabs, more or less. Longer waiting periods, restrictions on the time in which abortions can be had, restrictions on medical as opposed to surgical abortion. Increasingly important as medical abortions become an increasingly, as I understand it, at least an increasingly large percentage of abortions that are provided. Restrictions on insurance coverage as more and more insurance coverage involves states as a result of the Affordable Care Act, subsidies provided by the federal government or by states, efforts to say, well, this is like the Hyde Amendment. You're supporting abortion. And we understand we can't forbid them, but by golly, we're not going to spend our tax dollars in support of them as more and more government funds are spent in insurance markets. There's sort of efforts to insist that insurance policies, health insurance policies, not cover abortion. All of those some of those are in litigation. I don't even want to, I mean, things are so uncertain now in the courts, I don't even want to predict which of those will survive. Had the last election come out the other way, I would have some confident predictions, but it didn't, so I don't. So that's where things stand legally. The result of this, as far as, well, you know, can you get an abortion in the United States, is a complicated story. The answer to that, all these years, 44 years after Roe against Wade, you would have thought, well, the answer is yes, you have a constitutional right to an abortion, which you do. But in practice, here is the story. In urban areas, abortions are relatively easy to get. In rural areas, they are not. There's no abortion provider in the counties where 39% of women in childbearing age. In some of these states, big states, there's only one abortion provider. There are both these sort of logistical barriers of having to travel a long distance. The state imposes waiting periods that makes it even more difficult to get it, as well as social barriers. I have my views about these issues, of course. The one place where I think, with some confidence, I think the law has failed us, is the following. I can see the court saying, look, abortion's a controversial issue. People have very strong moral views on both sides of the issue. We're going to stay out of this. We want the political process to settle it. That's not my view. I can understand that. What I don't understand is the courts allowing society to reconcile its ambivalence, society-wide ambivalence, not that individuals are ambivalent, but we as a society are ambivalent about abortion. What I can understand is the courts allowing us to reconcile our collective ambivalence by essentially setting up a system in which if you're well off, or if you're living in the right place, you'll be able to get an abortion. But boy, if you are a scared 19-year-old in some rural community in North Dakota, you know, good luck being able to get away from your family, get away from your job, go to the clinic, which might be 200 miles away, being told, no, you've got to come back in 24 hours. Not like you're going to be able to get a hotel room there. And if you can't afford it, you're not going to get Medicaid to pay for it. You know, that's not the way to resolve this issue, by saying if you're influential and well-to-do and basically well-off. I mean, I'm exaggerating. It's not 100%. It's not black and white. But, you know, if you already have advantages, you'll be fine. If you already don't have advantages, if you're living in a deprived part of the country, if you have a kind of job that's not going to be very forgiving, if your family relationships are already fraught, you know, and you're young and scared, you're out of luck. That's not the way to resolve this issue. Whatever the right way to resolve this issue is, that's not it. And you could really make an argument that we've just gone down the wrong road, that it should have been, okay, let's make a decision. Are abortions going to be freely available in the United States or not? Let's make that decision. Whatever that decision is, let's live with the consequences. And if politically politicians can accept the blowback they'll get from influential middle-class women, affluent women who want abortions, if they can accept that, okay, that's democracy. I can see that argument. Agree with it, I can see that argument. But I really think one thing the courts ought to be able to do is to say to the government, we're not going to let you offload your uncertainty onto the backs of the people who are disabled about it. And I think the courts have allowed that, and I think that's a failing of the law. Whatever else one thinks about this difficult issue, I think that's a failing of the law. So that's my spiel for you, and I guess we have time for questions.
Problem the way we are doing it by letting rich women get what they need. want, and poor women suffer. May I remind you that before Roe v. Wade, that was exactly what poor women in the United States, where if you lived in New York or some other state, you did have access to abortion, and if you had money, you had access to abortion. But you had no access to abortion, just like now, if you lived in Texas or God only knows all of those places. So I guess my point is that I don't have any confidence that had we gone the other way, it would be any place different than we are now. We have a very polarizing issue, and I don't see how we're going to get the two sides in one place, but I think that the, where we ended up isn't so far away from where we were before Roe v. Wade was decided.
Yeah, it might be, it probably is inevitable that people with resources, people with influence will get their way, whatever the law says. And, back pre-Obamacare, if you really need an abortion, you have money, you could want it. And have an abortion. So it could be that, and that is built into the system to some extent. My real concern is the court has made it worse. I mean, instead of kind of identifying this as a problem and saying, we are going to do what we can to make sure that the same rule applies to law. They see this oblivious to that concern. And maybe, there's no way to say, if you want to forbid abortions, we are going to make sure that you forbid abortions even when influential people want to get them. Maybe there's no way to do that. But they just seem not even to identify that as something that they should worry about. But this is an area in which the reason the political process is playing out the way it is people who otherwise are in position or otherwise in a good position in their lives in society are protecting themselves, and we are allowing the society's reservations about abortion to be visited on people who can protect themselves. So, of course, it's so easy to care about that.
So there is this divide in terms of resources, but I wonder if it's maybe not so surprising that this is the situation we have. I guess I was wondering, maybe attitudes towards abortion are different in urban and rural areas, and maybe that's the reason we have the situation we have now.
Well, it seems to be true, because you see these laws coming in some states and not in others, but these areas are not homogeneous. There are plenty of people in rural areas who do not like these laws, and there are sure plenty of people in New York, New Jersey, and California who are for life and don't like what's happening in their jurisdictions either. So to say, the other thing is, if the Supreme Court is going to say there is a constitutional right to abortion, then to allow a state to go out and say, I guess there's a constitutional right, but we are going to do everything we can to make it next to impossible for someone to get an abortion. No, we should not be doing that. I mean, come clean on it one way or another. And if you're going to say the people who want to allow abortions, they get the forbidden abortions. If you're going to say that. Now, maybe you can't bring yourself to say that, and that's your problem. And that's what problems are about.
Yeah. So getting to the point of limiting abortions, is there any sort of basis for questioning the constitutional validity of the Hyde Amendment? I mean, in terms of just saying, we're not going to finance the abortion?
Absolutely. I mean, when the constitutional Hyde Amendment was first challenged, which is in the mid-70s, mid-80s. It was a 5-4 decision upholding the Hyde Amendment, where Justice Hyde was unconstitutional. The way the issue plays out as a matter of constitutional law is one side says, look, just because you have a constitutional right doesn't mean the government has to give you the money you need to exercise that right. You have a right to freedom of speech. The government doesn't have to build a website for you and buy your printing press. That's one side of the argument. The other side of the argument goes something like this. Do you mean to tell me that a government could say, okay, you have a right to an abortion, but you better not use the public roads to go to the abortion clinic. You better find your own right of way to the abortion clinics. Hire a helicopter.
pay someone to go through their property. Don't use the public roads. That amounts to us supporting abortion. So that's the, and this is, it's a, there's no clearance that it's an embedded problem in constitutional law. It's actually quite interesting what happened to that case. As I said, at the time it was 5-4 in a pretty conservative court. It was not a court that you would have thought was especially liberal. But that idea that the Hyde Amendment is okay, that is really settled in, and you don't really even see Democratic politicians challenging it, which is kind of one of the things that bothers me about this issue. When people on the sort of liberal side of the spectrum were engaging in their fantasy dreams about what the Supreme Court would look like if Hillary Clinton won the last election. I mean, one of the things that some people thought was okay, we can get the Hyde Amendment declared unconstitutional. But even that wasn't seen as, we're about to do that. That's going to be number one, step number one, let's do that. And that wasn't even that. So there's an odd kind of willingness to accept the idea that you have a right to an abortion, but people don't have to pay for it, which I don't get that. I mean, I actually get the there is no right to an abortion idea, which I don't agree with, but I get it. The reason I don't get the Hyde Amendment.
Thank you so much for that comprehensive talk. My question is, the liberalization of laws pre-73, were they all legislative, or were any of those court decisions?
Well, that's a good question. Yes, there were a couple of court decisions, but most of the liberalization took place in the
So what were those court decisions based off of? Was it also a privacy argument, or was it different line of?
It was some version of the privacy argument. The argument that was not in the picture at all, including in Roe against Wade, was an argument that abortion law, laws forbidding abortion, constitute discrimination against women. That was not in the picture at all. It didn't get in the picture until Casey in 92, and then it was not a central theme. It was kind of a secondary theme. The reason for that is that the body of constitutional law forbidding discrimination against women, saying discrimination against women is unconstitutional. That actually developed right around the same time as Roe against Wade. So that was very underdeveloped in Roe against Wade. Was it's not a coincidence that came along at the same time. It's change in understandings of women's role. But that was not in the picture today. You would think that would be a central argument. Mm-hmm. This is something that's it's not just privacy. It's something that has to do especially with women. In fact, Justice Blackmun's opinion in Roe against Wade contains some passages that are kind of cringeworthy about this is a decision to be made, something like, I've not got this right, but close, to be made by the intending physician in consultation with his patient. As if he makes, he makes a decision. Of course, he's going to talk to the person who's going to have the abortion. But that was the thing.
The abortion decision.
The abortion decision.
And the Whole Woman's Health case, is that the first instance where public health became a big part of this argument? Or was that introduced in earlier decisions?
No, that was really the first Supreme Court case in which these regulations of abortion clinics played a role. As I said, there was kind of a shift in strategy from we're limiting abortions because we care about the life. Who were living abortions because you care about women. There was that shift in strategy, and that led to the laws and the Supreme Court decision. KC was really much more informed. Consent requirements, notification requirements, waiting periods. It was all, this is an impulsive, a big decision. You have a human life in your hands, and we want you to think about it, rather than you might hurt yourself.
To
the
change in the court. Johnson administration, we were very careful not to look ahead into the future. And I ask you, what do you predict over the next couple of years?
One reason I didn't want to say anything is I hate to be the case that a lot depends on specific people who get on the Supreme Court. I don't like that. It's just all who the justices are, and it's not about the law. Having said that, I think if there are if there's another appointment of this administration, certainly if there are more than one appointment by this administration, that that I think abortion rights will certainly be cut way back. The only issue will be will they ever write a sentence Roe against Wade survive the year. I used to say confidently they'll never write that sentence. And I guess I still think that because of what I said about how there was pushback and it was mobilized the other side. But what I do think will happen if there are more opponents by this administration is kicking, and holding up a holding increasingly severe restrictions. I think that will happen. And then if we, I don't know if they survive, get through the next 4 years of that, any more opponents, and things change, then we can continue to get it.
First question is, don't you think it's going to be like contraception, where eventually down the line we'll get to the point where it's just accepted? And my second question is, why do you think there's been this shift from things happening in the legislative arena to things happening in the courts?
That's what they thought after Roe gets laid. They thought this is going to be just like contraception and it was accepted. And it hasn't happened in a long time. It hasn't happened. It's possible that I'm just guessing now, but it's possible that medical abortions become an increasingly large part of the landscape, that because they can be done in a low visibility way and because it's kind of a less, it looks like a less gruesome thing, that we could see a similar trajectory. It's just a matter of taking the pill and going home. And that'll kind of dampen the opposition. And then I can imagine that trajectory taking place, in which case, maybe there's less opposition and the balls will be repealed, or more likely just to get in the work. People do it well about it. Of course, it's intrusive, it's hard to know. I can imagine that trajectory. But the division really seems, for whatever reason, undoubtedly attributable to some degree to religion, this division just seems to be higher in our society to a greater degree than other societies, not comfortable societies. As far as why the shift, people will say, well, it's because of our own state, that the Supreme Court had either just stayed out or done something incremental instead of something sweeping, you'd still see action in the legislature. Once the Supreme Court says first trimester abortion, laws forbidding first trimester abortions are unconstitutional, that forces opposition to abortion rights into the courts. They've got to go to the courts. No defense. You've got to concentrate on judicial opponents. And if you're going along the legislature, it's just going to be struck down by the courts. That's a force.
Julie, what
do
we have a talk coming in this series in a few weeks from the one person doing abortions?
Mississippi?
Yeah. We do.
Lloyd Parker.
Lloyd Parker. Yep. So the only one in that state.
May 3rd.
Please join me in thanking the rest of the
Thank you.